And welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera, Blind. I am the RPG chick. Finally finished exploring Circus Minor. And so I just want to make sure that I'm recording, and I am. Okay, we're headed to Government Square because our friend Tiber wants his friend, or acquaintance, to not be executed over here by having a... Is it over here? No, that's a cultist encampment. It is over here, yeah. By having spewing out words and having them come out as his guts or something like that. Or they come out and they form tentacles which then suffocate him or something. Yeah, pretty horrible death over days and days. It's pretty extreme. I mean, just chop the guy's head off if you have to do it. I mean, why do it like that? Anyway, I am really hooked on this game, and I can't wait to see what is in store in all the different sub-districts and beyond the city. So let's go.
Let's go.
Interesting. Tidal affinity skill. Guy's like leaping forward here. Government Square. Sangolin. Sounds familiar. Greetings. Hello. What do you do up here? Are you a clerk? A messenger? A spy? Ooh, no. Don't tell me.
I'm going.
Sangolin sounds familiar. Do we run into him before? Oh, I was told by the name right, Samaban, to for my journal to click the purple arrow. Okay. It gives you more details about the quest you're in, what you're looking at. Kasmin and Mimion describe Metkina as pale-skinned and very, very dangerous. She's known in the city as the White Death. Metkina was most recently sighted in Underbelly, so the people of that district might know where she's hiding. Okay. So what's this do? Let's just... Oh, the question... The exclamation mark means you haven't done this yet. Tolmager, a slaver in Circus Minor, has enlisted my help to find her ward, a girl named Rin. If I bring Rin back to her, Tol says that she has valuable information to trade in return. Tol thinks that Rin is hiding in the district of Cliff's Edge. She described Rin as scrawny, with dark curly hair. She also said that Rin suffered a head wound and tends to babble about her gods. Huh. Right. For Linda, a bookseller in Circus Minor, has accused me of borrowing a very rare book and never returning it. I have no memory of such a thing, so it seems likely that the changing god was the real culprit. Perhaps when he was wearing the body that is now mine. It seemed important to Felinda that I find and return the book. I need to find the book that I supposedly borrowed. Felinda didn't provide any clues about its whereabouts, but did mention that the book has a five-colored sigil on its cover. Yeah, here's the one I mentioned. A man named Riss is slowly being executed in Circus Minor. His friend Tiber asked me to help save him. Tiber has a plan to forge a stay of execution, but he needs my help to get the materials for the forgery and deal with the authorities. Tiber's plan will require me to impersonate a city official, so I'll need one of the badges that all city officials possess. I can purchase a badge from Sangolin. That's the name. There you go. I could purchase it from Sangolin, who runs a clothing shop in Government Square. Cool. It might be possible to rally the spectators who have gathered to watch Riss die. If I'm persuasive enough, I could turn them against the execution and intimidate the official into freeing Riss. And the Sorrows pray. Zayofi, a sculptor and circus miner, witnessed the murder of a man by the Sorrow, the same creature that is hunting me. Now he's obsessed with sculpting the moment of the killing, but all his attempts have been failures. He cannot immortalize the victim until he learns more about him. Sorry, guys, I keep coughing. I have some tea here, but it's a little too hot to be drinking it yet. Zayofi told me that the victim's body was taken away by the Dendra O'Hur, probably to their chapel in the underbelly. So this one, fallen to earth, what's it say here? The two people who found me have conflicting opinions about where I should go for help. Allegern suggested I speak with the cultists of the Changing God. You know, I figured we'd find him there. Because we did speak to those people. While Calistas directed me to the Order of Truth. I guess he told me he's hanging out somewhere. I've learned that the cultists of the Changing God are encamped around a great clock in Circus Minor, and that the Order of Truth is located in Government Square. Cool. The three figures in the clock were actually reflections of three castoffs. Yeah, see last episode. Camos, Deviatku, and Velan. I should return to Casmi and Amimion at their encampment in Circus Minor and tell them what I've learned, which I have. Find a way to escape the Fathom. Figures in the clock surged into my mind and unlocked, or perhaps created, a new Fathom. I'm now trapped in the Fathom with them. If I speak to them, perhaps I can find a way out. Which I have done, of course. All this stuff is completed. Casmian, the local leaders of the Changing God cult, may know something about the Resonance Chamber. In exchange for their knowledge, they have asked me to discover the identity of mysterious figures trapped inside the clock, a device crafted long ago by the Changing God. Complicating matters, the clock appears to be unmoored in time, so I won't be able to investigate the figures until I've realigned it with the present time. When I tried to interact with the clock, tidal forces erupted from my body and brought several nearby devices to life. This might provide a means to repair the clock. Yes, see episode 10. I've realigned the clock with the present time. Now I can interact with the main clock face and investigate the trapped figures. Did I bring this up about the resonance chamber again? I think I talked to them again, didn't I? Let me just go check, guys. Because after all, I've did that for them. Even though it helped me, because I met more, you know, aspects of the Changing God. I keep wanting to go and then click there.
As you wish.
I hope they add that to a future update. You know what? Yeah, I can't. I wanted to just see what version we're running. I don't think it's been updated. You return, revered one. How may we assist you today? Now, I did sleep here for a price. I hope we can find other places to sleep where we don't have to pay. Alright. Tell me again who can lead me to the one who can repair the resonance chamber. Oh, Matt Kena. That's what. I bet you even says in the log, doesn't it? Farewell, beloved vessel. Well, I can't say I've ever been called a vessel before. That's new. Duh, yeah, it says here. Alright.
On it.
On it. Sorry about that, guys. Continuing to exploring and talking to people and stuff. I'm wondering if any of these people who run around, I'm going to need to catch them. Like, if it'll be worth my time to do so.
Right.
We've got a mercenary and a glaive. I'm on business for Aratha Bren. It don't involve you. I'm surprised people live here. It isn't exactly safe. I can't shake the feeling I've been to this city before. Maybe you have. Alright, let's talk to Sangolin. Hail, Sangolin. A tall, thin, and exquisitely dressed older man stands in the shade of an... What was all that sound? Sounds like something being torn apart. Exquisitely dressed older man stands in the shade of an exquisitely crafted stall. The cut, color, and quality of his clothes are a symphony of harmonious coordination, while the expression of benevolent condescension he gives you would be more at home on the face of a king. Good afternoon, he says, bowing slightly. I am Sangolin, and this is my store, Sangolin's Fittings. Welcome. How may I be of service? I gotta find a source of that really strange sound, but I'm stuck in this dialogue box. What do you sell here? I sell the finest city wear for discerning men and women, as well as quality armor for those traveling to less civilized locales. Hello? Cool-looking Finn guy. He clears his throat and directs your attention to a well-dressed mannequin wearing the badge of a city official. Also, it is our honor to have been chosen to provide the city of Sagus Cliffs with the official badges worn by all properly credentialed city employees. You may trust in their trust in us. Alright. Try to stick... Wow. I'm gonna try not to steal it. Tell me about Government Square. Of course, madam. Puts a finger to his chin. Let me think. There's Council Tower just over there, and the Order of Truth. And you can't forget the Red Thicket, that walled courtyard on the edge of the square. Or were you quite curious about our fountain here? Yeah, let me just get some general information from them first, some small talk and stuff. That is such a strange sound. Tell me about Council Tower. It is ancient beyond reckoning. The tower's roots go all the way down to the forges in the underbelly, and within it sits the Council of Sagus Cliffs, the finest, fairest legislative body in the Ninth World. And I don't say that just because they are my valued patrons. They have run this city well for centuries, and thanks to me they look magnificent while doing it. What can you tell me about the Order of Truth? They are a credit to our city. Wise scholars and deep thinkers, he smiles. Excellent customers as well. They are very particular about their robes. What is the Red Thicket? The Whispering Wood, I call it. A very curious and ancient place. You can speak as loudly as you like in there, but none but your partner can hear you. A great place for diplomacy. Tell me about the fountain. One of the stranger and more poignant attractions in the square. The creatures in it are called jallies, and they chatter in a thousand dead tongues. Is that what I'm hearing? The priests say that a new jally is born each time an old language dies. He shakes his head. You could listen to them for a month and never hear the same language twice, or understand a single one. Well, I'd go crazy listening to this crap. I don't know how you put up with it running your stall all day. Tell me what you know about the people in this district. I'm not one to gossip, sir. Sir? But if you insist, who do you wish to know about? Why do you call me sir? Have you seen a white-skinned, hard-faced woman in the neighborhood? Very tough and dangerous-looking? He frowns for a moment, thinking, then nods. Yes. In fact, I believe I sold her a cloak once. The way she wore it, it seemed as if she wished to hide her face, which, with a face like that, I could readily understand. He looks in the direction of the council building. I got the impression that she might do secret work for the families, but I wasn't about to ask. Can I buy an official city badge? City badges are not for sale to anyone. They are given to duly elected or appointed public servants of Sagus Cliffs, and it is illegal for me to give them to anyone who does not work for the city. I would be breaking the law. He considers, of course, most public servants do offer me some remuneration for materials, but no. No, I would not take the risk, nor betray my trust. He thinks, too risky. About 80 shins worth of risk, I'd wager. Tybear says, ah, but you won't be breaking the law. My friend here has just been made undersecretary to Overseer Yin. A messenger should be coming shortly with the letter of commission, but you know how Yin is. Always a bit sloppy with his paperwork. Let's be diplomatic here. Thank you, Tybear, but that's asking too much of this gentleman. Perhaps we could mitigate the risk to him? Sangolin presses his lips. I'm afraid I am unbribable, my friend, but if you were to purchase this fine pair of red boots for, say, 80 shins, it's possible I might leave something of value in the left boot by accident. I love talk like that, so funny. 80? Ah, it's like half our money. I won't pay that. Can we talk him down? He was thinking 80 as well. Then it appears we will not be able to do business. Are you certain? When we get boots out of the bargain too. Hopefully, they better be good boots. It sounds like a reasonable price for boots. I'll take them. Very good, madam. I'll wrap them up for you. You'll find the extra buckle in the left boot. Good, because this guy's obviously eavesdropping.
I'll remember that.
Good. Is that all for today? Can I interest you in our fine collection of armor, perhaps? Hey, let me see what you have. I gotta get it, but no, this is him. I just like looking at all this crap. Avatrol leather jerkin. Only usable by the last cast off. That's very nice of him. He sells stuff that only I can use. Can't be much call on that, right? Yeah, please buy it. No one else can use it. This simple garment is fashioned from the hide of an avatrol, a belligerent and spiteful beast that roams the beyond in packs. Avatrols are immune to most energy attacks, and their skins retain a certain amount of this resistance after death, so avatrol leather is popular among hunters and explorers of the region. The tough material is also thick enough to offer a minimal amount of physical protection. You know I'd get it, but all of a sudden we don't have that much money, do we? I didn't buy it, did I? Where'd it go? It's not here anymore. No, I don't want that. Shit. Pardon my French. I must have been... I thought I hit close. Oh, I thought this was close. I hit buy. Damn it. You guys must be laughing at me right now. I should have kept it. I put it back and he bought it for like half or something. Alright, don't press that button. Cobbled Brigandine. Still only usable by me. -3 to might and speed, -15% on esoteric attacks. 2 armor, 1 resistance. This stout leather body armor is reinforced with small metal plates. It is heavier than a leather vest and provides more protection. Most of the metal plates are ordinary steel, but a few are made of more ancient and exotic materials, which imbue the armor with minimal protection against non-physical attacks. Spaces have been left between the plates so that the armor remains flexible, offering the wearer some freedom of movement. Plate armor. Only usable by me. Individual pieces of metal plate have been bolted together atop a chainmail hauberk in a fashion that allows them to articulate freely, offering the wearer a good range of motion and a great degree of protection. Micromesh. Cool. Two armor, three resistance. Micromesh is a net of finely woven metal, fitted together with extraordinary precision and shaped into a suit that protects the wearer's entire body. The insignificant weight of this armor, as well as the flexibility of the synthetic material, means that it barely inhibits movements. It is highly prized by nanos and jacks. Yeah, I think I want to get this one. Whenever we have, you know, more money again. Three resistance. I got three resistance, no armor. And this is three resistance, two armor. Grounding cloak. An artifact. One resistance. When damaged by energy, chemical, mental, or transdimensional damage confers grounding cloak plus 15% on all tasks. I guess that's what that means. One use? I guess per rest? I don't know. This cloak, while heavy, has a very smooth surface when touched. It has a little static electricity on the outside which creates small sparks when holding something metallic to it. A brown substance that contains small web-like lines impregnates the cloak. Impregnates it? Connecting to wiring embedded in the fabric, the cloak has the capacity to absorb overwhelming electrical charges. Cool. That sounds pretty neat too. Then we got shields. Yeah, we know what those are. Okay, so what do we have here? Red boot. Let me get out of this so I don't automatically sell or buy anything. These seem like plain red leather boots, but when you touch them, a wave of sadness and disgust at the greed of humanity repulses you. You can't even consider wearing them. Really? Huh. Badge of office. We got it. This metal badge was meant to be worn by a city official of Sagus Cliffs. It is inscribed with the seal of the protectorate. Cool. Alright. This merchant stand displays expensive clothing and finely wrought armor. Alright, let's go check out this fountain then.
Allow me
to check out the fountain. Wealthy townsperson. Where are you going? Get back here. Fine day, isn't it? Fine day. Alright. Alcen.
Alright.
This fountain is constructed of a material that seems halfway between wood and stone. It doesn't contain water, as might be expected. Instead, it's filled with swarming, tiny, fish-like creatures that leap and cavort in a wriggling mass, chattering to each other in what sounds like a thousand different tongues. So natural lore. These are jallies, nearly harmless creatures that are usually found in clouds above the sea. What they're doing in this fountain is an utter mystery. Let's just listen to what they're saying. You fold your arms, listening intently to the fish jabber at each other. It sounds like a cloud of nonsense syllables mashed into baby speak. Listen some more. The fish-like creatures continue to gibber a song of melodic syllables and broken words. And ditto. Examine the fountain. The fountain, now that you're looking at it, is unfathomably. Why can't I say that word? Unfathomably old. Oh, I had trouble saying that word. Coppery tongue, fathomably. Unfathomably. Okay. Coppery tongue-like decorations curl up and over the rim of the structure as if lapping at the endless stream of creatures within. Yeah, I just had to be able to say that. You take in the surrounding architecture before returning your gaze to the fountain. The structure easily predates the buildings in this plaza and possibly the city. It might even be older than the Ninth World. Alright, let's try to catch one of these then. Why not, right? Let's not use all our effort. Nope. You thrust your hand into the slimy mass of creatures, but they easily slide through your fingers. Retry cost. One speed. Why not? I really don't want to use everything. I won. Yay. We got one. You deftly snatch a single fish from the glistening, tumbling flood. The bubbling mass of remaining creatures squawk together in nonsensical outrage. Is this thing gonna die? It says it was flying through the air, though, in the skies. So they can be in... They won't die? Guys are watching me catch fish. You caught this creature from a fountain of sorts in Government Square. Small, fish-like, and constantly squirming, it never requires food or other nourishment, and it gibbers constantly in an indecipherable language. You know, I wish they wouldn't put buy and discard so big like that. Because I'm gonna get things messed up. See, here there's nothing. You should make a little one, you know, because... I don't know if it's from Pillars of Eternity. I'm gonna talk to this guy in a second. Let's see what these guys have to say. I can't really talk right now. The negotiations are at a crucial point. Oh, never mind that guy. He left. Not now, dear. What are you calling dear? Where'd this guy go? Here he is. Let's go talk to him before he moves away again. Awesome hair. Oh, it's not a guy, it's a girl. This woman seems to be absorbed by what she's doing. Her blue eyes narrowed in concentration. You realize that she's the nicest looking person you've seen in a while, and feel almost compelled to approach her.
Yes. Nice.
Such beautiful colors, she murmurs. She meets your gaze. It would look lovely on you. Colors of what? Who are you? Seems so rude to say who are you, you know, just introduce ourselves first. But I don't even know what my name is, right? So, my name is Alcen Perie. You can call me Alcen, if you like. She offers a tentative smile. I'm a chirurgeon, but I work mostly with children. You know, healing scraped knees and the occasional broken bone. We're lucky here in Sagus that it's rarely anything more serious. I thought all chirurgeons work with children, you know. What do I know? So many children need my help. Too many, she thinks. Oh, house of empty time. Can you tell me about this place? Of course. This is Government Square, home to the City Council and the Order of Truth. The rest is embassies and city records, but you might enjoy a stop at the Red Thicket. She points to a red stone enclosure nearby. What are you doing? Waiting for an appointment, she says with a tentative smile. I heard that you're the keeper of the House of Empty Time. Then you must have questions. Ask away. How does it work? Why is it a secret? Why are you in charge? Can I adopt a child? Right. How does the House of Empty Time work? So this is related to that kid back in, what do you call it? First zone we entered here. A child enters the gate and emerges in another time to find a new family waiting for them. Willing parents register with the keeper in their own time period, and after rigorous questioning have their names added to the gate itself. After that, she shrugs, who knows? The children have loving families, and those families have children to love. Why is the House of Empty Time a secret? Because it's not the strongest system in the world. No one knows how many trips the old thing can stand, so we use it only for those who really have nowhere else to go. Her face hardens, and if everyone knew about it, some of them would treat it the same way they do other orphanages. We'd find babies dumped in boxes, small children left crying with nothing but the clothes on their backs. She seems to come to a sudden realization of what she's saying, and two bright spots of color appear on her cheeks. She clears her throat uncomfortably. The people of Sagus have been very good to me, she says eventually. Why are you in charge of the House of Empty Time? Because I walked through it. She smiles at your reaction. So yes, I was an orphan, and yes, I'm from another time. One much earlier than the present. As a child, I had the unique pleasure of being able to read history books and imagine that my real parents were the heroes of ages past. Her smile dims. And before you ask, my parents in this time are dead, but we spent many happy years together, and I will always be thankful for the life they gave me. As for the gate itself, she looks at it fondly, when I am dead, or hopefully before, it will choose a new guardian from those who have passed through it, and I'll have someone to keep me company through the end of my days. Not a bad bargain, all told. Let me just re-ask her this stuff. How's it work again? The guardian in each time registers orphans and willing parents. Somehow the gate matches them, and when a child passes through, they find themselves in a new time with a new family. No one really knows how the gate decides who ends up where, but it seems to work out fine. Why is it secret again? We don't want to overburden the gate or burn out whatever makes it work. We save it for those children who most desperately need our help. That way we can be sure we're using what we have for the best possible good. And why are you in charge again? Because I've been through it, so I know what to expect, and because I have the heart for it, which not everyone does. Could I adopt a child? I'm afraid not, she says. One of the main requirements for adoption is a stable environment. If you ever decide to settle in Sagus, then we could talk. Huh. Well, farewell. Take care. Oh, cool, look at these things. Like drones or something. This zone doesn't seem that it's that big. Well, then we have all this to go. But these big buildings are going to take up most of it. Seems like it could be a smaller zone than the one before. The one I couldn't remember the name of, which is Circus Minor. Alright, thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time when we explore more of Government Square. Endure and enduring. Restaurant.